1957 with some of the biggest professionals in Georgia broadcasting. Mike McDougall and Bob Peterson, who helped start WCHK AM radio station in Gilmer, Georgia. Byron earned his first class radio license, which was then required of every radio station, and worked in every job at WCHK for over 40 years, from copywriter to news editor, to salesman to vice president, and then general manager, a job he held for over 35 years. In 1997, Byron decided to retire from WCHK in November of 1997. His last day at WCHK was filling in on a Sunday morning for a part-time. Byron then went to work for the next day at WLJA-FM and WPGY-AM in LJ. Byron soon joined with Randy Gravely and became part owner of WLJA and WPGY and has been there ever since. Byron was named Broadcaster of the Year by the Georgia Association of Broadcasters in 1997 and was inducted into the Georgia Association of Broadcasters Hall of Fame in 2008, as well as named as Cherokee County's first citizen in 2017. Byron has been broadcasting for over 60 years. I have lots of good memories, and I know all of you that have lived here all your life have lots of good memories of Byron. I was talking to him just a minute ago, and I said, anytime anything was going on in Cherokee County, here came Byron in his little car, and usually, my growing up, I remember N.J. Tippins. Byron continued on at the station, and N.J. went on to build houses or do something, you know, and went on with his career. So, back in the day, whenever a store opened up around here, they did a lot of live remotes. So Byron was always there to christen that store and kick things off and give them a lot of good advertising. So I'm very thankful to have you here tonight and to share your memories of Cherokee County. And I know and I hope you all enjoy it. To begin with, Larry Cavender worked with Byron at the station for a number of years, as well as Tim did. And Larry would like to say a few things to begin with before we have Byron come on and talk to us. So this may turn into kind of like, this is your life, Byron Dobbs. So we'll see. So Larry, if you'll share with us some comments.
I guess you'll be
like Karen.
I didn't realize Karen was going to put me on the agenda. I thought when Byron saw me walk up here, he'd say, oh my God, what the heck have I got myself into here? I'm honored to introduce Byron tonight, and I want to share some of my memories with him. I worked with Byron for 13 years, and of all the men in my life, with the exception of my dad, he probably influenced my life more than any other. I've known him personally for 45 years. As a matter of fact, he was the best man at my wedding, and we were talking about that earlier. He asked if I'd hold that against him. I don't. But not long ago, some of you know how turbulent my marriage was to my ex-wife. And I saw a photo of Byron and me in our tuxedos standing up there at the altar. And Byron was grinning like a possum. And I looked like I was. He looked happier than I did. But I wish Byron had grabbed me by the arm and dragged me outside and said, son, do you know what you're getting yourself into? But I found out anyway. I've known Byron personally, like I said, for 45 years, but I knew of him a long time before that. I remember when I was 6 years old, I'd get up in the morning, eat breakfast, and we would listen to radio. We used to listen to WSB, I remember. But in April of 1957, right after my sixth birthday, and I'm telling Byron's age here, we started listening to WCHK. So every morning I would listen to Byron and all the other guys and hear the local news. I remember a few years after that, I was thrilled when Dad came home. He had just purchased a new FM radio. We didn't have an FM radio. WCHK had become FM, and he bought it so we could hear the ball games of the Cherokee Warriorettes, who of course were dominant in the late 1963. State championships in 4 years, and I was tickled to death, and I've listened to Byron and N.J. Tippins do their play-by-play of the ball games. I didn't realize that a few years later, I would join the team. As a matter of fact, it was a winter day in January of 1971. Someone told me that they no longer worked at WCHK, and they needed a DJ. If I was interested in the job, I'd go by and apply. You remember who it was that told me that?
I know. I'll hold it against them, though. Who was it?
Bubba Van.
Okay.
I had Mr. Stemp say, ooh, DJ sounded like an interesting job. 2 weeks later, he left WCHK, and he said, go. So I went by and applied. And while in jail, was taping me and doing some things. Byron was checking my references. He called J.L. Dobson, who was my dad's boss at the Kent Dodge in jail. I don't know why, but he put in a good word for me. Next thing I knew, I was hired. And Byron asked me, can you come in tonight and start training? I said, sure. I had a date with a pretty blonde that night, but I called her to cancel. And so I trained that night until midnight, came in to sign on the next morning at 6, trained all day until midnight that day, did the same thing on Saturday, came in early on Sunday, and by Sunday night, I was a radio personality at WCHK. Byron gave a lot of us young boys a chance. As a matter of fact, and it's sort of ironic, I've got the names listed here. I wanted to do a connection to Ball Ground, since this is the Ball Ground Historical Society. But there are a number of boys from Ball Ground who worked at the radio station, myself. And then, of course, after I'd worked there about 2.5 years, I was overseas with the Georgia Air National Guard on a deployment to Germany. And while I was gone, he hired this fresh-faced young boy, and when I came back, he said, you're going to have to train him. It was him.
My brother. And he was furious because I had already asked him if there were any openings, and he said, absolutely not, and I don't want us working together. And I said, well, okay, fine. So when he went to Germany, I went down and asked what Byron if I could have a job, and he said, yeah. So at the dinner table, I told him that Sunday night, I said, I've got a job. He said, where? I said, I start working at WCHK tomorrow, and you're supposed to train me. He was mad.
I got over it. And I did train him, and I think I did a pretty good job because Tim is one of the most beloved DJs they ever had at WCHK. I see people now, and they say, they think I'm Tim. I said, no, Tim didn't even go by Cavender. He went by Tim Lawson. But they don't remember me, they remember Tim, you know? They don't remember Larry Cavender, you know? So I must have done a good job training.
You were tough on me.
But in addition, there was Chris Clayton. Chris, I don't know if Byron realizes, but Chris's mom and dad sitting out over there. I was gonna mention Chris, and there I saw Leonard and Louise walk in, you know? Another one I was gonna mention was Dick Bird. Well, right there's his brother, sitting right back there, you know? So a lot of boys from Ball Ground got their chance to work at WCHK, but I don't want to take too much time because I'm sure Byron's got a lot more interesting tales to tell than I do. But Byron was a fast talker. Remember those commercials he used to do? But he was also fast on his feet and a connection to Ball Ground. I remember one day he was taping a gospel music program for a man who had a program on WCHK for years and years, and he was a mutual friend of mine in Byron's. And Byron just off the cuff said, go by and visit the little country store with a great big heart. And that moniker stuck with A.J. Darby's Circle K Grocery down through the years. I remember Byron was very supportive of an idea I came up with back in the early 1980s. I worked in conjunction with the Ball Ground Masonic Lodge, the Ball Ground Opera. Do any of you remember the Ball Ground Opera? Few of you do. Ball Ground was a swinging place back then. WCHK would broadcast about every 2 weeks a live country music show from the Ball Ground community building. And the funds that were raised from that helped the Masons build their fine Masonic Hall they have over there. Byron was very supportive of that. I also want to talk about a funny story. Right after I first started working in 1971 with Byron, that spring we had the first Ball Ground Spring Festival. And Byron always covered local events. And I tagged along with him and N.J. Tippins that day, and they set up shop at Jeff Grant's Furniture Store, which is now where Richard Hathcock's store is. They had a parade. A lot of Native Americans, the Cherokee Indians, came to sort of kick it off. And I don't know if Byron remembers this or not. when the parade started, I saw one of the prettiest girls I have ever seen in my life. I fell in love. My heart started beating the minute I saw her. She was a Cherokee Indian princess. Do you remember? Well, some of my facts or memories are confused now at my age, But anyway, Byron and MJ sent me off on a little errand, and I came back, and they told me that they mentioned to this girl that I had a crush on her, and told her who I was. And she said, "Oh, I think he's cute. I'd like to go out with him." So I didn't enjoy the first Bob Brown Spring Festival, because I spent the whole day chasing after that girl. And I'd come back and ask Byron and NJ, "Where is she?" "Well, I think she went that way, this way." And I checked, never did catch up with her. But fate had a hand in this, because about 3 months later, Tim and I, with our mom and dad, we went to Cherokee, North Carolina. And we took a tour of the Okunilufti Indian Village. And we were being tour taken through, and I looked over and I saw one of the other tour groups, and who was leading that tour? Shirley Swain. That's her name. I still remember her name to this day. So I left that tour and started chasing her and following her around. Finally caught up to her and told her I wanted to talk to her. She had to step out of her tour group to talk to me, and she thought, "You know, what's up?" And I told her how it was. "Do you remember me?" And she said, "Now who are you?" Well, then she told me what had happened, that they were playing a joke on me the whole time, you know, Byron and NJ. Anyway, very quickly, I also want to tell a quick story about my association with WCHK. In the spring of 1974, I had the mobile news unit with me that day because I was servicing some accounts, and I got sick, extremely sick, went home, called Byron and told him I was sick, and he said, "Don't worry about bringing the mobile unit home, just stay at home and try to get well," and I went to bed. I was listening to the station that night because we had a brand new disc jockey by the name of Bill Kelly. He'd just come to work for us. Some of you may remember Bill Kelly at Norton. But something happened that night, and Byron called me. He said, "I know you're sick. Can you get out with the mobile unit and cover some things for us?" Because I had been hearing through Bill, and Byron had gone to the station. That was the night of the tornadoes over in Yellow Creek. So I jumped in the mobile unit, headed to Yellow Creek, saw the devastation, reported on it. From there, I went to Pickens General Hospital and reported all night long. And that was one of the most rewarding experiences of my life. And I think Byron will agree too. I think because of the efforts of Byron and the guys who worked at WCHK, there were some lives saved that night. And all of these things you'll notice happen right around here. Bob Brown was a big part of WCHK, and WCHK was a big part of Bob Brown. Look at my watch now, and I see the Childress Chevrolet time is about 7:20. You guys remember that? Childress Chevrolet time? I'm going to close, because I don't want to take any more of your time, by saying this. Byron has often been called the voice of Cherokee County, but I disagree. He's more than that. WCHK was Georgia's good neighbor, and Byron is the voice not just of Cherokee County, but all of North Georgia. We had fans all over, and people all over North Georgia know Byron Dobbs. Also, I want to take just a quick moment to thank Byron for giving a shy, some of you say, "You're shy." Not anymore, but I was shy when I was younger. But thank him for giving a shy boy a chance and having faith in him. Because my experience at WCHK changed my life. As a matter of fact, I had to learn very quickly not to be shy anymore. So Byron, thank you for that. And I thank you for all your help. If it weren't for you and my experience at WCHK, which was one of the most enjoyable, interesting, and rewarding chapters of my life, the man we see here before you today would not be here. Thank you, Byron.
I suppose Tim will be next, since I'm being roasted. You know, Larry mentioned several things that brought to my mind. I remember when Tim came to work, he was not old enough to drive. I don't know how old you were, 15?
15, yeah.
So Mary Edwards, who was our office manager, would go to Cherokee High School. You got out at what time?
1 o'clock.
1 o'clock. She'd go pick him up. He'd work all afternoon. And when his dad got off at Camp Dodge, he'd come pick him up and go home. Tim saved his money. He was very frugal. He bought a new car, and it got his in the parking lot soon afterwards, I think.
Yeah.
Also, Larry was talking about the basketball. And I remember doing basketball games, and there was a junior varsity basketball coach, Tim Brewer, I believe was his name. But, you know, in a broadcast of basketball, it's several hours, and I had to go to the bathroom during it. So at the half, Coach Brewer would come by, and I'd ask him one question. How's your junior varsity team doing or something? I'd go to the bathroom. When I came back, he was still talking. He was my break. Larry mentioned that I was best man at his wedding. I went to NJ and Susan Tippin's 50th wedding anniversary a few weeks ago. And I remember they were married at First Baptist Church in Canton. Reverend L.R. Whitten was the pastor. And NJ was very nervous before we went out, and the preacher said, okay, don't worry about it. Said, two can live as cheap as one. If one goes naked, and the other one goes hungry. Tim, people thought Tim was a magician the day before he was a magician. Explain how you did the request time, Tim. Well, I don't know that I know it all. Stand up and explain it. Because we had a reel-to-reel recorder was the entire source of our recorded information.
Yeah, we had a reel-to-reel recorder, and what I would do was I would take people's request on the phone while a record was playing, and I would always pick up and say, WCHK, what's your request for today? And they would tell me their request and all that. So I would go back, and I would cue up that point where they would tell me what song, and while that record was still playing, I would go find that record, and I would place it on the turntable. I would cue it up. So when I go to the request, I would give the time, I would give the temperature and all that, and I said, let's go back to the phone, who is this? And they would give me their name and make the request, and I would immediately play it. And people were wondering, how could you find that song so quickly? And they didn't realize that it was recorded, but they thought it was live because I was always giving the time, you know, things like that. So they thought I immediately located it as soon as they requested it, so it became sort of a, you know,
an inside joke, really.
Yeah, really. Because people were like, gosh, you find the record so quick, you know. But they were already pre-recorded, but I would always cue them up. So I'd always announce the time or something, and or do it right after commercial. And like I was on the air live, but actually what they were hearing was just a portion of me live, and the rest of it was taped. So
it was a very popular program. He was very good at it. I remember a lot of things about Ball Ground. How many remember Hubbard's store? Miss Cora ran it. I think it was her, a sister, a brother, and I believe they lived upstairs. And they ran the store. She'd buy one ad a week. I'd go by every week. And she'd buy one ad, and it was typed on a typewriter that was in script. And I would go over it with her while I was there. And occasionally she'd get in new shipments of things, and she'd have in it that we have a new shipment of shoes. We have both step-ins and lace-ups. First, I had no idea what step-ins shoes were, but I soon learned. But that she was a charmer. I loved her to death. I call it Hathcock Club. If you call it Hathcock, and that's like Jordan and Jordan and all of that. Oh, speaking of Jordan, Karen's grandmother ran the story. Where was it? The Donna Lynn shop, and I was doing a broadcast from there one time, and she was there. How old would you guess? Four or five?
I was a little older than
that. Anyway, she should have known better.
Eight.
But I said, what do you want to do when you grow up? She said, I want to be a ballerina dancer. She's ready for it now. I remember the Ball Ground Festival. I didn't remember the Indian store exactly, but I remember the big firewood. There was a new fire truck, I guess, one year was the focus of the Ball Ground Festival. The Canton Cotton Mills, how many had connection? Everybody had some connection with Canton Cotton Mills. I remember when they went on strike, and neighbors against neighbor, and there are people today that don't speak, that were next door neighbors after the strike of a cotton mill. The Days Inn across the street used to always flood. It still does.
Yeah.
It still does. I also was talking to Karen the other day, and she asked if I remembered when the Hickory Log Creek would flood. Before they built the shopping center and the Hickory Log Dam, the road was low and it would flood. It didn't take much rain and people would go through it. It'd be about this deep. And people would come up in their cars and go through it. There'd be a bunch of us, including me, lots of times sitting there watching, just see what Boo would try. And then get about halfway out and stall out, and a bunch of us would go push them out. Did you ever go out there and get pushed out of that? You weren't a rider there again.
We watched that. I always tell them to play, and I don't remember who sung it, but how high is the water, Mom? I always count on that when the rains came.
John
Cash.
Is that who it is? Okay.
Who?
John Cash.
Probably was.
Yeah.
I've done lots of things. I will be in broadcasting 60 years on April 11th. Mm-hmm. I started April 11th, 1957, and started very young, of course. But I turned 82. I will turn 82 in August. I don't feel like it. I don't know how you're supposed to feel when you're 82, but I don't feel that I'm that old, actually. My father died when he was 50. I was 15, and I thought he was an old man until I got there. And it was quite different. I love my job all these years. I love radio. Bob Peterson, Mike McDougal came there from WSB, and they were big wheels in their day. They were the morning newsman and the morning announcer at WSB for years. So they had a built-in reputation when they came in. To be honest, that's probably the thing that made WCHK an instant success, which it was. The day we opened, we got calls from everywhere. I remember from down the street at LN Bottom store, they called and said, "We're here," and we said, "Where are you?" "We're just right down the street." So, we're engaged in a project right now. I'm going to plug myself in it. We are at WLJA. We were at 93.5 at one time, and a station in Tennessee wanted to move into Cleveland, I believe, and increase their power and be a mega station, and they forced us to move. They took us to court. We lost. And we had to change frequencies. And since that time, we've never been as powerful as we were then. But today, we are building a new tower. In fact, it is up. Everything is done except hooking the transmitter to it. We're probably going to do that week after next. We're going to double our power, and it's a 385-foot tower, so we're beaming it towards Cherokee County. So that's one of our big areas in our market is Cherokee County. So we want to get our signal in and cover things in this area. The staff of WCHK have been numerous people. I remember when Tim got the job and how mad Larry was that he got it because he told him, "Don't you go there and apply." And he got the job while Larry was off in the National Guard. Some of the people there, Don McClellan worked there for 1 year. He came from Tennessee. He had replaced Tennessee Ernie Ford at a station in Tennessee. He came to Atlanta and wanted a job at WSB-TV, and since Mike and Bob had the connections at WSB, we had lots of people who went from WCHK to WSB and then on up in the ranks. But Don McClellan came, and they told him he wasn't quite good enough for TV to go to WCHK and work a year and come back. The whole year, he smiled. Everything he said to me. The first day he went to work, they said, "Wipe that silly grin off your face." He practiced it for a whole year. When I retired in 1997, as he said, I went to work the next day at WLJA. That still covered news, local news. I went to a commissioner's meeting in Canton this week, city council meetings. I do all the things I've done all these years, and I still love it. It got in my blood, I guess, and I made a career of it. And one of the stories that I did one time, a female shopper exited a convenience store and a man grabbed her purse and ran. The clerk called 911 and told him about it, and the police came, and she gave him a description of the man, and they caught up with him. He brought him back, and he said, "Yeah, that's her. That's the one I robbed her." The radio business is quite different than it used to be. When Tim and Larry worked there, we played actually records. Yeah. We don't even have a record player in the building today.
I'd have to be retrained. We both would.
We would what?
We both would have to be retrained.
Oh yeah,
it's so different.
And we're going to a new music system when we change onto this transmitter, the new tower, even different than what we do today. But all of our music is on the hard drive. And it, we have a program that pulls the songs up. We give them the parameters. We have songs listed as light, rotation, medium, and heavy. And in that system, it will pull up the songs. In the new computer, we're going to be able to do things a lot different. For instance, I personally like bluegrass music. And we have some bluegrass gospel music in our computer. With this new system, we can tell it, program it, that we want a bluegrass night on a Saturday night or something. It'll automatically play that kind of music. So the radio business has gone a long way from when it wasn't. And very few stations have live announcers these days. Most of them are voice tracked, and they may be in California somewhere. Bill Kelly's still working. Bill Kelly, talked about Bill Kelly and Norton. I remember he always talked about his mule. One morning we got up, and there was a mule tied to the sign out in the front yard. Somebody had brought him a mule. He works in Cornelia now. He still does Norton voice, and he was the best at the transition of the voice of anybody I've ever heard. He didn't know which one he was. I mean, he talked to Norton, and Norton would talk right back, and he invented Gober Beach. He started talking about Gober Beach, so that became a landmark because of Bill Kelly. But he's still in the business. He's probably 80 now. But there's been some interesting people work there, and it's been a fun job. But about Bob Brown, I love it, still do. I've been involved a long time, and I hope you don't get mad at Kira because she didn't make the ballerina.
But I will tell you this, and Byron probably forgot about this, but I worked illegally at the radio station. I was an illegal announcer.
Yeah.
You remember that?
Because you didn't have a license.
I didn't have a license. I could not pass. Oh. Back then, you had to have a third-class radio telephone license with a broadcast endorsement. And it required those three sections to pass, and you had to have broadcast endorsement in order to work on the air. And I couldn't pass it. I went for a whole year going to Atlanta trying to pass this thing. And it got pretty serious to the point where Byron, when I worked on Sunday afternoons, Byron would tell me, he said, "You keep the doors locked because if anybody comes in from the FCC, we'll lose our license and we'll be..." Well, one afternoon, all of a sudden, this bald-headed man comes in and he walks into the control room and he says, "Where's your general manager at?" And I went, "Oh my God." And I said, he's at home." I said, "You call him right now and you tell him to get here immediately." And so I called Byron, and I said, "Byron, I don't know who this man is, but he's requested that you be here." Byron gets in the car and comes to the station, and I'm all shook up because I thought, well, I've lost a job, and the station's going to be no more after this visit. And it turned out that Mike McDougal, the guy that started the station, I had never met the man before in my life. He just walked in and told me to call Byron. He wanted to see him right now. It scared me to death, and scared Byron to death. We thought we were done, but Byron finally told me, he said, I'd studied that book. It was, and he said, "Tim," he said, "when are you taking the test again?" I said, "It's going to be another week." And he said, "Have you been studying?" I said, I don't know what else to do. I've studied. And he said, "Well, you know, if you don't pass it this time, I'm going to have to let you go." I know you probably don't remember that.
I know.
And I went, and I was surprised, but I passed it. I finally passed it. Then about 6 months after that, the FCC did away with the whole thing.
The FCC inspector's name was Angelo Diddy at the time. And I remember that he walked into the building. I was there at the time. He walked into the building one Sunday afternoon, and he just started toward the control room. In those days, the general public could not go into the control room. It was off limits. He immediately started for the door, and I just walked in front of him. I actually didn't know who he was. And I said, "What do you want?" And he said, "I want to go in there." I said, "Well, you can't go in there." He said, "Well, you know, I could pull your license." I said, "Who are you?" He said, "I'm Angelo Diddy." Later years, I sold my house I lived in 40 years out in South Kent, and I moved to Bridge Mill, the Bridge Mill community. I bought a condominium there. And about 6 months after I moved there, Angelo Diddy bought a condominium down the street from me. I nearly fainted. We'd have community meetings, and he always wanted to talk to me about the radio business. He had retired by then, but we had this retired doctor live there, and he'd say, "Angelo, shut up. He don't want to talk about radio here today." But Bridge Mill was not one of my favorite places to live. In fact, I hated it. I bought the model condominium. It was beautiful, but I absolutely hated living there. I now live in a condo in Canton. I've got some real nice neighbors. My next door neighbor's 92, and she keeps a real tight rein on me. She knows everything I do. But are you Dick Burns? Are you Dick Burns?
I'm his brother.
Brother. He still works some for us. We have a license in Douglasville. We've just leased it, but Dick has worked there off and on for all the time we've had it.
Yeah, I saw your station in his bedroom.
Yeah, that's where it used to be. It's probably been moved out of there by now, because we've leased it to the company that's running it. And
yeah, they actually rented a space to put it in.
In his house?
No, they rented them a space.
And Jack and Dick's dad used to do all the lettering on
the car. On the sign outside.
Yeah.
Tim, we helped you out with the request line. You didn't know it, but when we first got married, our phone number, we lived at Canton, and our phone number was 479-9145. And the request line was 479-WCHK, which was 9245.
Yeah.
And we got so many calls to our house requesting songs that we finally would just say, sure, we'll get that right on.
We had a weather forecast with one day that said it was going to be partly cloudy overnight. Well, it snowed during the night, about 2 or 3 inches, I think. And this little old woman called me up, and she said, I'd like you to come over to my house. And I said, for what? She said, to help me shovel. It's partly cloudy all night. It's that kind of thing that's made my job fun. I've always had fun at it. I still love it. And I expect to do it for a long time. Anybody else got a question about anything? Tim or Larry, I one probably can answer it.
Byron?
Yes.
Did you have announcements of people that were in the hospital, people with babies?
We did. We would call the hospital, and the, I don't know if she was a switchboard operator or anyway, a girl would give the names of the people in the hospital who were dismissed and who the babies today decided they have a act but put us under the jail.
I remember hearing that when I was little.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And
we
Christmas.
Had three. We had the General, R.P. Jones, and Cherokee Automatic.
Yeah. We used to at Christmas, on Christmas Day, I would always go in the morning and for 2 hours, let the kids call in and tell me what Santa Claus had brought them. And they would get so excited that they could hardly talk. But it was really fun. Like I said, I've had a fun job. I've loved it, and I've done well at it. And I'm glad to be here.
I wondered if we could get to talk to a little bit about Canton Cotton Mills. I know that was a big deal back in the day when Canton Cotton Mill met its demise. Can you talk a little bit about
I can't a whole lot, not firsthand, but I remember the strike really put them under. I had a lady stay with my mother in the last few years of her life, a sitter, and her husband had worked in the mill and was old enough to retire, and it closed, and he still thought the union was the greatest thing in the world. And she said, you fool, it took your job. I don't know if it took his job or not, but it closed. Then I was telling, what's the guy from the Funk Heritage Center?
Joe,
tonight, that when they built the Walmart, there was a union hall, I guess, there that they bought, and they started grading it, and the federal government, somebody stopped them. They brought in archaeologists, and they dug up all these Indian things in the ground. Well, 2 or 3 years before that, I bought 30 acres right on the river and put up three towers down there. There's no telling what's down there. We never heard of it then. And it's still there, though, because we didn't dig anything up. But Joe said, you got to come see what we've got. And I remember they worked for weeks there. They brought in some college students that dug and picked out these pieces of artifacts. But right on the river, which is what they used, was the river. There's no telling what's down there. I had a guy come by one day and he said, I see that you've got all this property down here and the grass is growing up in it. If you'll let me, I'll cut that for you for the hay. I said, yeah, that's a good deal. So for years, he cut that grass for the hay, kept it in immaculate shape. 10 years after I left WCHK, I saw him one day. He said, I've just learned you left WCHK and I'm still mowing that grass. I said, just keep it up. They probably don't even know they own it.
I think during the training portion, when they would train you, they would talk about be aware of your transitioning from one program to the next. You know, that And we used to, after the 5 o'clock news hour on Saturday, we did the Sunday school lesson that the Baptist Association would do, and I would work Saturday night. And I remember this one particular time, and it was one of those times where I wasn't using my mind or thinking, but I had my record queued up, so I was outroing the Etowah Baptist Association Sunday school lesson. You know, you're saying thank you for joining us for the Etowah Baptist Association Sunday school lesson. You can hear it each Saturday afternoon from 5:30 until 5:45. Well, now it's time for country music here on K-Country, WCHK K-Country. Here is Fair and Young, and here I am in Texas. Where in the hell are you?
That reminded me of something that happened to me one time, too, talking about N.J. Tippins. Of course, we would do on-the-air obituaries as well.
Still do.
And I was doing them one afternoon. I think it was, what, 10 to 5, maybe did the weather, 5 to 5. And you're supposed to be very solemn, you know, of course. You don't want to laugh in the middle of the obits. As I was reading, in the control room, there was a window into a studio where we'd have sometimes singers that would come in, and you could see the singers through the window. Well, here I was reading the obits, very solemn, and I glanced up, and in the window, N.J. Tippins was mooning me. And I cracked up. I turned the mic off. Didn't go out of the air. I turned it back on. It took me about 15 minutes to finish the little bit screen. Another time, a lot of times we would tease the news, you know, we'd come on at 15 until noon to talk about what was going on. And one year the Pope was visiting. And I thought I came up with a real catchy little tease. I said, we'll have all the news on that as well as more poop on the Pope. We got a lot of complaints from people calling it like that.
I remember in the early days we used to play jokes on the guy. As he said, the control room was here and then there was a studio out here. And in the earlier days we did the major newscasts in the studio and Mike McDougall did it and people tried to break him up. Jim Axel would actually set his news on fire, go in with a cigarette lighter and set it on fire. And one day, we got into this situation. There was four of us trying to obituaries. First, it was Jim Axel. Then I've forgotten who, me and somebody else, but we all were tickled. It wasn't a bit funny, the people that were, the funerals were on there. And as he said that, we still know obituaries. This is actually an obituary we got. I'm not going to call the name, but it's hilarious. And it was actually meant to be on the air. Mr. So-and-so, better known as Junior, age 69 of Dalton, on Thursday, came out of turn 4, took the checkered flag, and went to be with Jesus. Junior was born April 2, 1942, a son of late so-and-so and so-and-so. He was preceded in death by his brother Wade, sisters and brothers-in-law, and this one of them, strange in here. Junior, Ernest and Junior loved dirt track racing. He was owner and operator of Mathis Garage and Machine Shop. All this in his obituary. He survived his wife of 52 years, sons and daughters-in-law, and one of them was Jeannie and Michael, Fatback, and then their last name. It's not rare that we get them that have a nickname in them, and people don't know them by any other name. But we take a big editing pen to ones like these, and it winds up about a third of this before it actually gets on the air. Back to the cotton mill. I don't know a whole lot about it. I know that it was a big, big industry in Cherokee County. And I remember we used to do a program called, what was it, on Sunday afternoon? Down the Highway of Melody, I think. Bob and Mike came up with that, and the cotton mill sponsored it. And Rebecca Johnston's father was the controller there, I guess, and he was on it one afternoon, and she tells me this, I don't remember it, but he said, I'm the proud father of a new baby boy. She said that's when she learned she had a new brother. Her dad told it on the radio. Okay, I'm going to hush because I don't guess, you've got to get home in time to see the president at 9 o'clock.
Anybody have any questions for Bob?
Yeah.
I think you ought to mention your secretary that you had for so long down at WCHK.
Not what you want me to tell.
It doesn't have to just mention her name. I think she was there for so long.
Mary Edwards?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Fine lady.
She was. And she would bring her lunch. She'd bring a potato every day for lunch. She'd cook it in the microwave, and they were yellow something. They smelled so good, I'd starve every day. She'd start that potato about 11 o'clock. You got me a check. Oh, I did. My bill is $6,900. Is that what she said y'all had?
Jenny's got a question.
I was going to say, back in March 1963, I was in the Miss Cherokee County Beauty Pageant, and we went down. I had to ask off from work because I had just started to work for B.R. Jones at Citizens Bank, and it took a lot of courage to ask to be off.
To ask off?
Yeah. So I asked to be off, but go down to Canton, and Byron Dobbs was the one that was driving the convertible. But the sad thing was it was rainy that day, and we couldn't let the top down.
I remember one time being in a parade, and we were affiliated with WSB-TV at that time, and a WSB-TV announcer was there, and I was driving her in the parade, and it rained, and we couldn't get the top up.
You at WCHK, it would have been the fall, I guess, of 57, when the world's first Earth satellite was launched, and y'all decided to make fun of that event, and you put up a... You said you were going to launch a satellite.
A Sputnik.
That's right.
Bob Peterson had a character called Ole Svensson that he did the voice. Well, Ole built this Sputnik, he called it. And they would put up a power pole, and they built this crude wood around it. Somebody brought an old commode we put in, and I mean, it was really crude. But it was the talk of the day. And somewhere along the line, they decided it was time for it to blast off. So I guess it was Lent Lawson had a truck in the chicken business. They brought a power saw and sawed that pole off, put it on that chicken truck, and took it out and hit the flat and dumped it in somebody's pasture. And the next morning, Ole couldn't be found. Didn't know where he was. Then he looked out the window, and the Sputnik was gone. So they got everybody looking for it. Finally, somebody called in and said they found it in somebody's pasture out in Hickory Flat. We did a lot of crazy things, you know, over the years. But it was always fun. Got a lot of reaction. Yes. Thank you.
Anything else? Anybody have any more questions?
Is the check signed?
Just a lot of good memories of Byron always being around and keeping us informed of what was going on in and around Cherokee County, and still does. I listen to him on his LJ, on his, well, Jasper station, because you are in Jasper. So.
Well, the transmitter's in LJ, and the studios are in Jasper, and I'm in Canton.
That's
so
right. You got it all covered here. Well, we appreciate you coming tonight and sharing your thoughts and comments with us. And as a little token of our appreciation, our garden club is a working bunch of great ladies, and they have developed a botanical garden out here on the grounds of City Hall. So we have putting bricks out there in honor and in memory of other people. So we're so glad we get to say in honor of Byron Dobbs. We're going to have a brick placed out there in your honor. So here's a little certificate.
Thank you.
So when we get it down, I will let you know, and you come back and see your name in red Georgia clay, I guess.
Okay. Thank you.
Karen, what are the call letters of that radio station at Jasper now?
WLJA.
And the number?
101.1. When we bought the station, wonderful. It had been called LEJ. LEJ, WLEJ. And for some reason, Bobby, the woman who owned it, had changed the call letter. But when we built a newer AM station, we wanted to name it WLJ, but a TV station somewhere had picked up the call letters and wouldn't give us permission to do it. Mm. Lots involved in it. You can't just go down the street and open a radio station.
What's the CH station? What did it stand for?
And I never knew.
Some people would say Cherokee, some people said chicken.
Chicken, yeah.
Because we were the chicken capital of the world.
We were.
Poultry capital.
I don't know how many people go back that far, but in 1957, we broadcast a poultry auction from Gainesville every day, from 1 to 3, I think. And they actually sold the chickens that were on the farms to different people, then they carried them to them, I guess. But that we had strange commercials, and they would want commercials outside that program. And one of them was Merck and Pfizer pharmaceuticals, and they talked about worming your pigs. And they wanted it run early in the morning. And we got more complaints about people saying, I hate you running that ad while I'm eating breakfast.
While I'm having my bacon and sausage for breakfast.
You know, as we go on, things change, and so has the radio industry. But if you grew up around here and you grew up with Byron and WCHK, I'm talking about the Christmas morning, I remember that. And I remember it was a big deal when the weather got bad. Oh my gosh, the kids, we actually have a videotape of my kids calling the station repeatedly, are we going to have school tomorrow? Are we going to have school tomorrow? That was a big deal, you know, to stand by that radio and listen to see if there was going to be school the next day.
Cliff in Boston was the superintendent at one time, and he was the slowest man alive. He would not make a decision until his wife told him it was okay. That's what we figured. But anyway, late in the process, we started giving their home phone number. Everybody called. We don't know, but call this number there.
That is my dream. So Tim got really mad at me one time. Tim's a little younger than me, but I was working the night shift. And one winter it started snowing and sleeting, and Clevin Boston called me at the radio station. So I don't know whether to call off school or not.
What do you think? I've heard of that.
And he said, he knew I lived in Ball Ground. He said, when you get home, will you call me and tell me what you think, if the roads are passable? I said, yes, sir, I will. So I drove home about 12:30, 12:45 in the morning. I called Clevin Boston, told him, oh, it's going to be just fine. I told my brother the next morning, because he was still in school. He was not very happy with me.
And Wendell Anderson would call the radio station. He was always, I don't know if you knew Wendell or not, he was high strung. He'd call and he'd say, it's snowing like hell up here. We're calling off school.
Anybody else have any more fond memories?
Well, y'all know this is going to be a comedy hour.
Leonard's got something. Leonard?
Tim was talking a while ago about how WCHK had affected Ball Ground, and he was talking about Chris, our oldest son, working for WCHK. And WCHK has meant a lot to our family, and especially to me and Chris, because I used to play music with the Cherokee Valley Boys in 1957 on WCHK. And
every Saturday,
I truly enjoyed that, and Mike McDougall, Richard Peterson, and Jim Axel, they'll never know how they have affected my life by just sitting down there listening at them before we'd go record our program on Thursday night. And we'd get down there early sometimes, and I'd sit in there and listen at them, you know, going through commercials. Now, a lot of people might think, well, there ain't nothing to a commercial, but they'd sit in there, a couple of them, you know, and talk to one another and go over this, that, and the other on the commercials. But I thank God that Byron and them hard Chris when he was in 12th grade at Cherokee High, because when he graduated Cherokee High, he went to Shorter, and he was working at WROM over there. But as a result of them hard him at WCHK, he fell in love with radio and TV. And while he was going to Shorter, he called me and his mama up, and he says, look, I am not learning anything over here that's going to help me in my future. And he said, if y'all give me enough money to go take the FCC, you know, test and get my license, he says, I believe I can make it. So he went, as a result of them hiring him, he went and took the test, and he made real good on it. It wasn't but a few weeks he went to work for Ted Turner at Channel 17. Well, there was another corporation foreman, and he got acquainted with some of the guys at Up South Corporation, so they talked him to come in out there and helping them get it up in the air. So he did that, and then they Up South sold out, and Chris had to get him another job. So he put in three applications. One of them was at the Weather Channel, and I forget where the other is. And as a result of Byron and them hiring him when he was in the 12th grade, he fell in love with radio and TV, and right now Chris is the chief engineer at the Weather Channel. And tonight,
that's great.
Great lesson.
How about that?
That's
great.
Doing, that's
good to know.
Byron, I appreciate you, buddy, and what you stood for over the years.
Well, and I attribute Byron, you know, because of my first work there. I've always been in public information. I used to be public information at Amoco Electric, and I left there when I came to the fire department. It's helped me tremendously because, you know, especially during the times when we would do the election results, you know, Byron would tell us, you know, don't write anything down, call the results as soon as you come in and just ad-lib. And that was a good thing for us because it taught us how to be able to BS, you know, easily, as you have to do sometimes. And especially with the work that I do now, doing interviews for the TV stations in Atlanta and the radio stations too. And they have a good reputation. We have a good reputation with them because of the fact that I'm not afraid to stand before the camera. The firefighters are terrified of them. And I'm terrified of going into a house that's on fire. So I said, y'all go for me to the house. I'll talk to the news media. I don't have any problem with it. And that's because of starting with the radio station and learning so much from down there is why I have succeeded in the jobs that I've had over the years of working with the fire department now and working for Amoco Electric. And it's made a big change in my life.
45 years later, I'm still doing yours.
Yeah.
Having been in the public eye all my life in this business, a lot of people will say to me, and a couple have said tonight, I know that I've never seen before, I think. But Tim's boss, Chief Tim Prather,
yeah,
is at every commission meeting. I go to them all. Every time I go, he speaks to me. About 3 weeks ago, I was named first citizen of Cherokee County. My picture was in the paper. He came in and said, I want to shake your hands. I didn't know who you were. I thought you were one of the boys from the Tribune. Couldn't see him for years.
See, we all, you can tell by looking at us, we all had a face for radio. We have a face for television, but we had a face for radio.
Byron touched on a little bit about the Masonic Lodge. Back when the guys, as most everybody knows, call it the Zeman Building, the Masonic Lodge was upstairs, and that building is so old and it was in such bad shape. And so they set out on a mission to build a new Masonic Lodge. So on Saturday night, it got so popular, you wouldn't believe the local talent at that point in time, and we may have it now, but we've kind of grown that. We've gone through growing pains, but back in those days, as Leonard said, he had a group. We had so many talented musicians around here. It was unbelievable. And they started the Ballroom Opry. And you wouldn't believe the people that would come to Ballroom on Saturday night to listen to our local folks play and pick and sing. And they started airing that opera show on Saturday night live. It was on AM. Was it on FM2? But, you know, how wonderful that was for that little station to have such a part. And those guys raising all that money to build that Masonic Lodge that they have out there today. So that's how the Masonic Lodge
They brought in so many people with the fire marshal. Got on to y'all.
I mean, the building would be packed. Yeah. And all the members of the lodge and wives, that's why I turned around and looked at Vivian. You know, we spent a lot of Saturday nights out there, hamburgers and pouring cokes and coffee and everything to help them raise money to build that lodge. So, and a lot of that, you know, money came because of the advertising they got off that radio station. And you mentioned just a little bit about the little country store with a great big heart was A.J. Darby. I don't know if any, I'm sure a lot of you that's been here long enough have heard of Circle K Grocery. Well, that was little uptown and up on Highway 5, and thanks to that radio station made AJ pretty much what he was because of the airtime that you got.
He sold the music, the type of music we played,
mm-hmm.
And people would call us, you know where I can get that? We'd say, sure, it's Circle K. Mm-hmm.
So it's been a win-win situation for a lot of businesses, a lot of people, and for that station. So again, thank you for coming. We appreciate you taking the time to come spend with us, and I've enjoyed it, and I hope everybody else has too. And if nobody has anything else, well, let's have refreshments. And if you're here and you haven't signed the guest book, please do that.
Karen.
And
I got one thing I want to do. I'll soon be 77 years old, and a lot of you probably haven't saw this picture right here, but I'm going to show it to you because you may not never get to see it anymore. This is a picture, a photo that was made in 1957 by Joe Young. A lot of you may not know Joe Young, but he lived up above Ball Ground here. He followed us around and recorded all of our programs, made a lot of photos of us. But this is Johnny Hughes right here. He was first in the pass away. This is our comedian, Johnny Joe Johnson. That's me on the guitar. And Paul Jordan, I have never in my life heard anybody that could play a fiddle like Paul Jordan.
Fiddling Paul.
That's Lee Hughes and Junior James on the drums. But like I say, this is made when I was 17 years old. But if any of you want to see it, get a closer look at it, well, you can. Thank you.
Thank you, Leonard. We've also got a sign-up sheet back there for refreshments. If you want to take a month and provide refreshments for us, we'd be very thankful for that. Again, the guest book back there to sign, and we've got some bags and ornaments and calendars. That anybody here that hasn't seen those, take a look at them. You might be interested in buying one of those. So if there's nothing other, anything else anybody has, we'll stand adjourned and enjoy our refreshments and coffee that Elaine and Sandra Finley has provided for us tonight. And thank you all for coming. I see.